Hey, we're here live at the Velocity Conference. This is SiliconANGLE, theCUBE, our flagship program. We go out to the events, extract the ceiling from the noise. Tony Parisi is here, CTO of At Large, also web guru. He's been involved in standards. Going back to the early days of the web, pre-web, information superhighway. You know, back in the days with Tim Berners-Lee and they moved to Cambridge, W3C. That was the beginning of the early days, which now is we're in web, whatever version we're in. Tony, welcome to theCUBE. You know, you've seen this movie from the beginning. You know the endings. You've been involved in the days when the standard buys used to jockey for position. What's your take? We're going to get into a range of conversation, but I want to get your take on the current web environment right now. I see a lot of forces driving change. You got, you know, at least faster internet, you got broadband, and that's getting better on wireless. You have mobile, obviously, is changing the world, everyone knows that, so that's kind of all known. But you got cloud, velocity. Here is about the intersection of design, user experience, meeting DevOps, basically, or WebOps. Right. Not just cloud, not just data center, not just enterprise, but really kind of the intersection of those two. So what's your take of, if you had to kind of peg a grade, give a grade to the current web, a letter grade, F, fail, A excellent, and what needs, what's happening that's hot that's being worked on?
So, as always, I give the web an A for effort in terms of user experience. Though you know, execution over the last couple decades has been kind of spotty, you know, if we wanted to do a performance grade right now, I'd say we're getting from the getting into the B plus territory, just in terms of being able to deliver a quality, rich experience, which is where I come into this, and all the work being done in performance, though it seems like it's back end work, really is a lot about delivering a responsive, rich user experience. So, you know, well on the way, and well into converging with mobile technologies as well.
Yeah, I noticed in your background you're involved in VRML, virtual reality markup language, which was, you know, right when HTML was still early days and web HTTP was just hitting the scene, and you know, we all kind of know where that went. Obviously the web is the web, and we want to talk about augmented reality, but before we get in there, and that kind of that whole scene is a whole nother level of user experience, which kind of is in your wheelhouse. But before we get to that, I want to talk more about, like, quickly the UI side right now. We're, you know, mobile, Facebook just launched his videos for Instagram, so that's a huge scale project, so that's WebOps challenge, and yet a user experience. So it's not Vine, it's not 9 seconds or 6 seconds. It's, you know, I mean, Twitter's got a 6 second video platform. I mean, I mean, it's kind of lame. So they're, I think they're sub-C in terms of a grade there, but, you know, getting better in terms of rich media.
Yeah, no, we're not. I mean, in terms of rich media, certainly HTML5 with user interface though has come a long way. I mean, you can build pretty much anything in HTML5 with the with CSS and spinny things and animations that rival any native user interface you can build, not only a desktop but a mobile at this point. When you get into the rich media, you know, video and especially 3D, which is my area of expertise, it's still coming along. I mean, there's basically bits and pieces of the technology platform that aren't there yet. There's a lot of practice that still needs to kind of evolve, you know, and I'm looking a lot at web performance of interactive 3D applications, and the issues are, they're still pretty significant. There's a lot of challenges there to make that, you know, a high performance rich media environment where you can just do it purely with web technologies and not have to fold in, say, you know, native.
Talk about HTML5, demystify the FUD that's being thrown around out there. There's a lot of weirdness going on around HTML5. Some are saying it's too hard to work with, other people are abandoning it. I mean, it's just kind of a weird environment right now. Can you just kind of clarify your views on that?
Well, my views only. It seems like there was a lot of FUD about a year ago with a couple of big companies saying it didn't work yet. The last couple of development conferences I've been at, I work with a lot of developers. I go to the conferences, I attend, I talk to people. There have been some amazing demonstrations of pure HTML5 mobile applications that have true native performance. It's all about doing the engineering properly. So those earlier efforts where those big companies were dissing, you know, dumping all over HTML5, you know, I don't know exactly what was behind those projects, but it sure seemed to me like someone had thrown a few junior engineers at it and said, see what you can do, as opposed to putting a real professional team on it, the way folks at Sentia and some of these other companies have done to really say, look, we have a web browser platform, it's not perfect, but we know how to squeeze performance out of it. Let's throw some performance people at this and make it really work. And they've made it really work. We can scroll infinite lists. You can zoom and pan and do all these amazing user experience things that people said weren't possible at all on mobile, let alone with HTML5. So I just think, A, you know, you had people looking at it early, and B, you didn't have the right really professional people doing it. It was a half-hearted effort, and then people just basically dumped on the technology instead of sticking
I just don't buy any of it,
long story short.
I totally agree with you. I think I would buy that. But, you know, let's talk about some of the market forces. Just the big dream right now is mobile, right? You know, you have a lot of dreamers. Right. And the dream is, okay, I can make more money with mobile. Obviously, the proliferation is phenomenal. So there's a rapid push to get something out fast. Trying to use agile that's not agile, but pushing out code that's not quality. And then you got a DevOps problem, right? So, you know, Node.js is an interesting dynamic right now on mobile, which is fantastic because you can do server-side JavaScript. It's really elegant and you can do a lot of cool things there. But still on the UI side with HTML5, there's the dreamer. I got to get my mobile app out. So a lot of these frameworks are developing. Right. Is that good or bad? I mean, is it because you have, it's almost, I want fast, but I got to do some engineering. So what has to happen? I mean, is it just get better coders? Will there be any tooling that will devolve, or what's your view on that?
Yes and yes. I mean, this is all part of an evolution of an ecosystem. So the tools are getting better. The browser platforms are getting better. People's experience with these technologies is maturing. So I think it's going to happen all in due time, but I think folks need to get their expectations set as well.
What do you think about, they assume
they can just write one line of code and it's going to work everywhere. It just doesn't work that way in practice, regardless, even between two browsers on a desktop, let alone with mobile.
And obviously you're in the 3D and the UX side. Obviously the stack conversation is always an interesting one. What do you think about Node.js and what that's happening with Node?
Well, I'm personally a huge fan of Node.js for server side because I love JavaScript. I've become a real JavaScript, say, acolyte over the last 5 or 6 years. My background is in pretty hardcore software engineering, C++, and all the industrial strength languages that came before, you know, a decade ago. But JavaScript's a great, easy to use language, and Node has made it really easy to program, very responsive, asynchronous messaging-based applications especially. Especially when you're talking to these new database technologies, Mongo and Couch and these kind of things.
We just had the Redis guy on earlier, just, you know, horizontally scalable.
Yeah, very, very scalable, very event-driven, makes really good efficient use of your machine resources on the server, easy to host in the cloud. So it's another area where some people had to pioneer, you know, LinkedIn was one of the first to build a mobile app with a Node.js backend. Yeah. And they really had to pioneer how to use the technology effectively. And they did a great job with it, but you know, the practice evolves, the tech, the tech underneath evolve, the tools evolve.
It's a classic example of the DevOps world too. The pioneers had to build their own because there wasn't any commercially available stuff. And which is I love, and this is the beautiful thing about the market we're in. But I got to move that quickly to your world, which is user experience, the design side. We see things like Google Glass, it's got this augmented reality, you know, that's like the birth, it's like the seed of augmented reality, it's not necessarily the product, but it can open the mind up to some creativity. And so, that being one end of the spectrum, HTML5 and other standards, what's in between? What do you see as the key things that are technologies that are available and work being done around, whether it's 3D or really good user experience stuff?
Well, so what I'm working in is a technology called WebGL. I write books in it, I consult with clients to build WebGL sites, and it's 3D rendering in your web browser. Works on a desktop browser, it now works on the mobile browsers. Doesn't work on Google Glass yet, to my knowledge. I've seen it work on one of those Oculus Rift head mounts that you strap on your head.
It's on Chrome.
And look around. WebGL is in Chrome. Yep, it's in all the browsers. It's coming to Internet Explorer. They haven't shipped it yet. So it's there.
They got to get tabs first.
Yeah, exactly. You know, they're catching up. And it's been leaked that they said they're going to do it. So you can create a really incredible, rich experiences, interactive encyclopedia, full 60 frames a second, video games, product visualizations, looking at CAD models, walking through giant architectural spaces. You can do all that in a web browser or on a tablet now with this kind of technology without needing, you know, the head-mounted displays, the glass, or any of that. So that's what gets me excited, having worked in that area close to 20 years ago when everyone did think it was going to be about attaching headgear and all that. You don't really need that. I mean, a lot of 3D graphics, like the games you play every day, you're seeing it on your TV, it's on a flat screen.
Yeah.
You don't necessarily need to have extra hardware for it to, you know, on the display side. But it's pretty exciting what's going on with Glass. You know, when they actually really make that work someday, I think we'll see WebGL and other web content really integrated in there, and that's exciting. But it sure seems like, from the reports I've heard, it's going to take a little while for that to become product quality.
Yeah, I totally agree. And we talked about that at Fluent, but the thing that it's interesting now is the 3D stuff we saw at I/O is fantastic in Chrome, for instance. You know, even in, you got Firefox going native. WebSockets now more important than ever before. I mean, you know, that's been kind of around for a while, but now with Node and WebSockets and the native browser, that's nice. It's a nice environment. Mobile, is it if that's currently kind of a nice position there, where's mobile relative to where you are in the browser?
It's sort of a giant family of stuff. So you got the desktop browsers innovating platform technology, but they're not the only ones innovating. I mean, they're farther ahead because you get sort of a fatter computer to work with than your typical mobile device. But on the mobile side, they're innovating all these use cases, all these, you know, sort of user interface paradigms, all of the app store kind of way to buy things, and all the swiping gestures. And that's something that, you know, came out of mobile first, very much a human-centered, human factors orientation. And now that you see that stuff influencing the design of new HTML5 technologies as well. So it's sort of a next step on a convergence path. You know, they're working on parallel tracks and they're influencing each other left and right here. So I see that as very exciting, sort of on equal footing, where the new cutting edge technologies will sometimes make it into mobile when the platform can handle it. And a lot of times these new user interface paradigms are influencing what happens on a desktop browser.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
Yeah, and you know, we were just commenting yesterday here in theCUBE about, hey, you know, the word mobile won't even be kicked around anymore. It's just going to be it.
It's it,
you know,
yeah.
It's web, mobile, web, the mobile, it's just another device, right? So
exactly.
It's interesting. So I got to ask you, with all that, right, what are you watching? What are you personally watching right now? So you're involved in the WebGL and you have that history. You know, you have a good perspective. You have a lot of experience. There's a lot of young guns coming into the market with CS degrees, hardcore programmers. And you got the newbies coming in and they want to just use off the shelf stuff. So what do you see? What are you watching for tooling, for platforms to accelerate that convergence?
Yeah, you know, this is going to be very specific and techy, but I look at you know, HTML frameworks and CSS frameworks like Bootstrap, technologies like that, style sheet technologies that, I mean, if you're looking at what web jocks do every day, they're spending a lot of time manually typing a lot of stuff. And so now we're seeing that getting professionalized to the point where you can build something that works mobile, works desktop, has a really crisp and easy to use user interface, so that's one area. Another area is on the performance stuff, that's why I'm here at the conference at Velocity, is the rich media and performance convergence is pretty intense, right? To be able to create a web application that doesn't fall on its face getting to the user when it's also delivering this rich media in this open environment. It's no longer Flash where, you know, you got one company, you can sort of just control the pipeline and how it all works.
Yeah.
You got to make all these technologies work together. So there's interesting developments going on here at Velocity in that area too.
Yeah, and the community is really tight knit community. It's not like the classic cloud show or front end show. It's a little bit of an integration, but we are starting to see the Velocity kind of positioning cross over to the mainstream. We've got some, you know, State Farm, big developers here from corporate. Guys, so you know, is it ready for prime? Is it crossing over? How much work needs to get done? Because now the corporate enterprise guys, whether it's a service provider or a corporate, you know, they've been down to the bone for, there's been no innovation in that market until now. They now see, hey, I can really change the game and have now hire developers.
Yes.
I can now rewrite and retool and drive value, not just be this IT shop.
Right.
So, you know, is that, where would you see Velocity now? Is it crossing over? Is the community getting bigger?
It has to, because you know, you're seeing all of this enterprise movement into the cloud. You're seeing all this application development go into the cloud. And you're seeing all of the sort of older proprietary software systems get their upgrades. Even from the people who made the software, they're sort of, you know, upgrading themselves to make this brand new, you know, kind of app where no distribution, no extra software to get. It's running in the cloud, it's running in browser. And in order to do that effectively, you need to bring those kind of technologies to bear that Velocity talks about. So yeah, I think it's time for that to come front and center. And it converges with the you know, 3D enriched media work I do. I'm doing a book signing here at the conference for one of the books I wrote, and you know, got a lot of interest in WebGL and rich media from
and
this crowd
here. And put a plug
here
for the book. What book is that?
It's called, the current book is called WebGL Up and Running, and you can get it on Amazon or O'Reilly's website today. And I'm actually doing a pre-release of a new book, Programming 3D Applications in HTML5. And so that's, you can go get the pre-release if you go online.
Tony's what we call a tech athlete. He's been there, he's seen all the movies before, he knows what the ending's going to be. It's going to be a good user experience. At the end of the day, that's what wins. Good performance, you know, relevant code, good, the right product always wins. Final question for you. You know, step back, look at, you know, looking at the 20-mile stare out in the industry, given your experience, what's out there that's going to happen in your mind's eye that people aren't talking about or might not expect, given all that stuff we just talked about? What do you see that might not be obvious to the people out there?
Well, we do get kind of tied up in our own little world here, but I think that we've got to remember, and this is a lot to do with mobile, what we're calling mobile, like you said, that's not even going to be a term in a decade, we're going to forget it, is that everyone on the planet is going to have multiple computers. Multiple computers that are mobile, their phones, they're all this, I mean, they don't today, but it's coming, even in the most remote parts of the third world. And we're all going to be connected all the time with the social media. What does that mean? I don't know what that world looks like in a decade.
It's going to be powered by some web ops infrastructure for sure. This is theCUBE, this is the Velocity Conference, this is SiliconANGLE's coverage of Velocity Conference. Go to the hashtag Velocity Conference, C-O-N-F, Velocity C-O-N-F is the hashtag. We'll be right back with our next guest after this short break.